basically, it started off as myself and Femi Blaze from Platform Magazine asked us to come up and play some records in their office, and they stream it and record it. And it's kind of built from that. We just started inviting friends down, and over a few weeks, we kind of built some kind of formula of a 3-hour jam with some records and some DJs, and it's kind of built from that in the past year. So now it's a live broadcast of a kind of private jam, really, you know.
Okay, and just a case of, like, as you mentioned, it started out, just got a few people coming down, play some records, have a good time. But now we're seeing people like Jamie XX, Mount Kimby, Theo Parrish, Rosker, James Blake. So some really big names playing at the night. How have you gone from, it must have been a year of doing the show to attracting such stars, if you like?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the whole point about the Boiler Room, is that we don't really see them as stars. You know, I'm a DJ myself. I have been for a few years, and I've worked with Giles Peterson on his radio show and what have you. So I know most of these guys quite well, just from being at gigs with them, emailing, shaking them down for tracks. You know, it's like just calling your mate and saying, yeah, come down, play. You know, Theo Parrish, he was over. I went to his hotel, picked him up. He came down and he picked up my records and started playing my records.
Amazing, that's what you want, right?
Like, he was like, yeah, this is the shit. Saw people smoking and drinking and was like, yeah, play records, yeah, let's go, man. And we just kind of broadcast that kind of vibe, you know. It's not really in a thing of like, yeah, you need to come down and play your set and, you know, entertain and what have you. Some people do that, like Roscoe came down and played some exclusives. And James Blake, you know, is before his album launch. It was probably quite a good buzz for him. But also for us, it was just a jam. It was just before Christmas and we had a good party and we broadcast it and recorded it and, you know. It's worked really well. We know all the guys at Young Turks really well. So they've been through Jamie or Samfa or whoever, Bullion, Mount Kimby. And yeah, it's the whole thing is kind of based off that vibe of it's a bunch of mates in a room playing records, and more people have come and more people have tuned in over the year. So, you know, I suppose it was capturing that kind of essence of there were a lot of warehouse parties going on in East London, and a lot of these guys are playing, and it'd be quite local, and it's kind of taking that local East London kind of warehouse party vibe, and broadcasting it to anywhere, you know, and people in LA, Lock-In, or Serbia, or Perth, Japan, wherever.
Well, this is the really intriguing aspect, I think, of the Boiler Rooms, is the fact that whenever it's happening, you can just get on the web, fire up Ustream, and check out what's going on in the Boiler Room. So you're sitting at your flat with your mates, you're playing some records. Where did the idea come from to stick a webcam up above the decks?
I don't know, Ustream was there. And you know, I'd experimented with Ustream quite a bit as well. I suppose the whole communal effect, just where you're inviting people down and they bring their mates with a can of Red Bull, can of Red Stripe, or like they bring down a bottle of Coke and a bottle of rum, a little bag and something to smoke, and you know, that's kind of just what
it was. Incriminating.
We never really kind of made a thing of the camera being there. We never really do. You know, it is obviously there and people can watch and what have you, but if you're actually inside the Boiler Room, whatever, wherever that is, we try not to make a thing about there being a camera in the room. You know, there's not a big red light ticking on it going on air or anything like that. You know, it's kind of a little bit of a fly on the wall kind of just there. You might see a little kind of like LED shining above it, but other than that, and we kind of slyly position things.
That's quite an interesting point, because I've heard with some of these nights that people have been watching the video, and because it's kind of, it's not an obvious thing, people have kind of been incriminated on camera for wearing like a ridiculous outfit or dancing like a bit of a fool.
I like that. A lot of people, you know, there have been a couple of notorious characters that have come through, but I mean, that's all part of it, isn't it? And you know, those guys, you know, the whole point about being, you know, a lot of people send emails or Facebook or on chat and going, how do I get into the Boiler Room? Like, as if it's kind of some hard task. It's not really, you know. you just have to know one of the guys that's playing, or one of us, and just email us and come in. And inevitably, anyone that comes in has the right vibe, whether they are wearing the right kind of top, whether they are particularly trendy or cool, or whether, you know, sometimes some guys get caught out trying to chat a girl up, but, you know.
Are you
speaking
from experience there, sir?
No, I was, it's quite funny because there was this one, I'm not going to name any names, but there was this one example where, you know, I was in the room, it was a good session. I didn't get a chance to check the chat room because it was quite busy, so I couldn't get anywhere near the computer. So, when I got back home, Twitter was firing off and this guy was being mentioned. I was like, what is going on? What's been happening? Like, and it just turns out this guy was caught chatting up a girl the whole session.
Yeah. Oh, mate.
So I suppose, yeah, I mean, you know, if you've got anything to hide in that situation, or you've got somebody hiding at home and you're in the boiling room, then it's probably not good. I mean, maybe that's the good thing about it. That's why, you know, people that girlfriends or boyfriends are happy with their partner going down to the boiling room, because they can watch them and see what they're getting up to.
And that you also do this kind of offshoot, if you like, which is live from.
Yeah.
Have you done a lot of those events, or is that something that's just getting started?
It's something that's just getting started. Over the year, we've kind of experimented. We did a party in Hackney Wick last summer, and we kind of broadcast live from there. We did a couple, but yeah, we did our first two. We did Sofrito, it's a tropical warehouse party in Commercial Road. And then we broadcast, we obviously did the Tiger Beer Get Me Party from Corsica Studios a few months ago. We had Marion Hobbs and the Hoya Hoya crew. I met her for the first time last week. Like, we've spoken loads of times and what have you. She was like, I'm loving the boiling. I was totally shocked. I was like,
that's a real boost.
Yeah, no, totally. I was like, wow, like a lot of what we've done, a lot of the sounds that we've put through the boiling room, through what she's pushed, and from the sounds of it, from talking to her, I can't really reveal anything because she didn't reveal a huge amount to me, but I kind of sense that there's radio podcast kind of situation with her coming, which will be great, because her leaving Radio 1 has definitely created a hole for that kind of really experimental electronic sound. I'm not sure if anyone's capable of covering it in the same way that Marianne can.
Well, that's kind of interesting as well. There's opportunity for another kind of offshoot, if you like, to take the Boiler Room TV to a radio format.
Yeah, yeah. I suppose it just depends. There are a few ideas running around, and you know, a few ideas will stick. It depends on what becomes viable, you know. And I suppose as a business, yeah, it kind of has to generate some kind of cash, but we're not really looking for that from the boiling room punters, as it were.
Right,
because
right.
Then it just becomes your normal club night, or
right. So you're talking more stuff like partnerships, getting people involved, doing stuff like live from and the radio side of it.
Yeah.
As well. Okay.
And you know, and the whole there's an audience participation in what we do, you know, that's always part of it, whether that's online or in the room. I suppose the time we put into it kind of has to cover itself, otherwise
certainly,
you know, burning the candles at both ends, working at the post office and doing boiler room as well. So
sure, and that kind of nicely brings us on to another topic which I wanted to cover. Obviously we focus on innovation at Intruders TV, but I'm interested to hear more about you, and is Boiler Room, is it a full-time project for you, or?
No, I do other things as well. I work at Soul Jazz Records. You can find me behind the counter at Sounds of the Universe 2 days a week, selling records, which I like, because, you know, it just means I'm up to date with exactly what's coming out and when.
Sure.
I've got another kind of production company called Hot Box Flat, and we do a podcast every couple of weeks, and that's turned into a radio show and syndicated on a few stations around the world. I'm starting to do some parties for XOYO, and a DJ quite a bit, all over the place, all over the world really. So
So it's all kind of, it all kind of feeds into itself. It's not a case of you work for a bank and then you just...
Oh no, I did try that. There was that point, but my boss at the time couldn't handle it. I'd be on the phone or on the email, looking far more concerned about my...
your project.
My moonlighting. than my actual proper job.
Yeah, but turning up to the office, panda eyes. Yeah, yeah. I definitely wasn't DJing last night.
I was, yeah.
Honestly.
Sorry. Well, I wasn't in the studio smoking trees at 5 o'clock in the morning. But I just couldn't get the idea out. But yeah, they didn't really care. So.